Well, thank you, Swami, for asking me to give this talk. It's actually a subject that's near and dear to my heart, and I've been collecting material for most of my 40 years at Vedanta, and it's a subject that I think a lot of people haven't focused on. Vedanta has had a great influence on society, but it's virtually unknown, and I think there's a purpose to that, which I'll get into. But first, some definition housekeeping. What I mean by Vedanta influence is not just the 120-year history of the Vedanta, Ramakrishna, Vivekananda movement in America, but the broader influence of Vedanta philosophy throughout Western history. The ancient Eastern sources of this influence can be traced back to the Vedas, which are among the oldest sacred texts in the world, thought to be between 3,000 and 3,500 years old. According to Swami Vivekananda, the Vedas are, quote, without beginning and without end. By Vedas, no books are meant. They mean the accumulated treasury of spiritual laws discovered by different persons in different times. Just as the law of gravitation existed before its discovery and would exist if all humanity forgot it, so it is with the laws that govern the spiritual world. Further, the New York Vedanta Center's Swami Tathagatananda wrote in his great book, Journey of the Upanishads to the West, unlike other world religions, Vedanta has no founder. It's not based on the authority of a single individual, but on the intuitive knowledge of a host of mystics who do not give us a finalized dogma or conventional creed that we must accept. Vedanta repeatedly tells us that experience is vital to spiritual development, not blind faith or adherence to external forms of religion and social and religious practices. The book meticulously details how translation of Vedic scriptures found their way to the West. He traces them as far back as ancient Greece. As richly detailed in Phil Goldberg's book, American Veda, we learn of the broad influence Vedanta has had on ordinary American life. Yoga studios across the nation, even in conservative Christian communities, teaching meditation, even in secular settings, the belief in reincarnation, words like avatar and nirvana, ideas like good and bad karma, are now commonplace in our national conversations, if not always using the proper definitions and understanding of the words. As a side note, Goldberg mentions that the Vedanta influence not only reverberates from India to America, but also back to India. He tells of an encounter with an ochre-robed monk in India. Quote, I watched him methodically plant seeds in the soil as he chanted Sanskrit verses. When he noticed me, he placed his palms together in greeting. I asked if he had been a monk since his youth. He laughed and said, as a young man, he viewed the religion of his ancestors as backwards and went to university to study science. When I asked what exactly changed his path, he replied, I took a class in American literature and I read Emerson. Let's trace some of those early influences. Sir Charles Wilkins went to India to work for the East Indian Company as a printer and writer. And in 1785, he published the first English translation of the Bhagavad Gita. His book was soon retranslated into French in 1787 and German in 1802. It proved to be a major influence on Romantic literature and the European perception of Vedanta philosophy. A Persian translation of the Upanishads was done under the rule of Emperor Akbar in the 16th century. But Europe didn't see translations until 1755, when a French Orientalist translated it into French and Latin. The first German translation appeared in 1832, and an English version in 1853. Max Müller offered a more systematic English translation in 1879. Ludwig von Beethoven was attracted by Indian thought. He was first introduced to Indian literature by an Austrian Orientalist who started a periodical for spreading Eastern knowledge in Europe as early as 1809. In describing Beethoven's spiritual development and beliefs, Sullivan says in his book, the credo of the Mass in D, which is what's playing, has an overwhelming note of authenticity. The words doubtless express something of which Beethoven was passionately convinced. But his conviction was probably better expressed in the mystical sentences he was fond of copying down from Eastern literature, such phrases as, I am that which is, I am all that was, that is, and that shall be. part of a creed that Beethoven copied out in his own handwriting and kept permanently framed on his desk. The fragments of Indian religious texts that have been discovered in Beethoven's manuscripts are translations and adaptations of the Upanishads and the Gita. Referring to one of these early translations, the great German philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer wrote, quote, "The Upanishads are the production of the highest human wisdom, and I consider them to be almost superhuman in conception. The study of the Upanishads has been a source of great inspiration and means of comfort to my soul. From every sentence of the Upanishad, deep, original, and sublime thoughts arise, and the whole is pervaded by a high and holy and earnest spirit. In the whole world, there is no study so beneficial and so elevating as that of the Upanishads." On a lighter note, for the last 27 years of his life, he lived alone in Frankfurt, except for a succession of pet poodles he named Atman. The mystical painter and poet William Blake lived from 1757 to 1827, considered mad by his contemporaries, but is held in high regard by later critics for the philosophical and mystical undercurrents of his work. Swami Saradananda finds a Vedantic voice in Blake's poem, Auguries of Innocence.
To see a world in a grain of sand and the heaven in a wild flower, to hold infinity in the palm of your hand and eternity in an hour. A nice poem, but it has very Vedantic interpretation. I am sure the writer, William Blake, he felt that Vedantic insight.
Copies of the Gita, Upanishads, and other Vedic texts found their way into the libraries of some of our founding fathers. Carl Jackson's book, Vedanta for the West, details, for five years, John Adams read widely and deeply of India and Persia, beginning with Priestley's books and continuing all the way through 12 volumes of Charles Dupuy and the entirety of Sir William Jones's work, among others. Adams wrote to Jefferson in 1817, "We find that materialists and immaterialists existed in India before Berkeley or Priestley or Dupuy or Plato or Pythagoras were born. Indeed, Newton himself appears to have discovered nothing that was not known to the ancient Indians." An interesting footnote to history for Vedantists is that Jefferson, Adams, Swami Vivekananda, and Swami Prabhavananda all died on the 4th of July. Jefferson and Adams on the very same day in 1826. All four figures held a very special place in their hearts for Independence Day, which for the Swamis meant spiritual liberation. Ralph Waldo Emerson, a leader of the Transcendentalist movement of the mid-19th century, received a copy of the Wilkins English translation of the Gita. In his poems, he describes nature and God in terms expressed in the Upanishads. In his essay titled Immortality, he paraphrases from the Gita, "The soul is not born, it does not die. It was not produced from anyone. Unborn, eternal, it is not slain, though the body is slain." Henry David Thoreau was an author, poet, philosopher, and leading transcendentalist. He is best known for his book, Walden, about living simply in natural surroundings, and also his essay on civil disobedience. I loved his expression, "Be not simply good, be good for something." Thoreau said in his 1850 journal, "What extracts from the Vedas I've read fall on me like a light of a higher and pure luminary." He also wrote, "In the morning I bathe my intellect with the stupendous philosophy of the Bhagavad Gita, in comparison with which our modern world and its literature seem puny and trivial." And here's another example of Vedanta's influence from America going back to India. It was Thoreau's civil disobedience that Gandhi drew inspiration for his nonviolent movement. In 1931, Gandhi told American reporter Webb Miller, "Well, of course I read Thoreau, and his ideas influenced me greatly." And then Gandhi's influence came back to America through Martin Luther King, who adopted Gandhi's method of nonviolent resistance for the civil rights movement. There's some controversy as to whether Walt Whitman was influenced by the Upanishads when he wrote his first book, Leaves of Grass. Many critics thought so. Initially, Whitman told Emerson that he was unfamiliar with the books, but later in life he claimed to have read, quote, the ancient Hindu poems before writing Leaves of Grass. In the introduction of Whitman in the Light of Vedantic Mysticism, Allen says, quote, the question of Whitman's reading of the Hindu poems still remains unanswered, but it's not really important whether he read them or not, whether he absorbed the ideas and attitudes directly or indirectly at second or third hand through American, British, and German transcendentalism, or most directly at all through his own psychology, which enabled him to intuit some of the oldest spiritual truths in human experience. The Church of Christian Science was founded by Mary Baker Eddy, who quoted from the Gita in the original church writings, but is later purged. Modern-day followers of Christian Science may not be aware that their founder drew from Hindu philosophy. Up to the 33rd edition of her book, Science and Health, first published in 1875, she quoted directly from the Gita. The wise neither grieve for the dead nor for the living. I myself was never not, nor thus, nor all the princes of earth, nor shall we ever hereafter cease to be. But some of the ideals and doctrines of the church remain influenced by Vedic philosophy, though unrecognized today. In addition to being one of the world's great novelists, Leo Tolstoy was also an influential moral thinker and social reformer. In addition to incorporating religious thought in his stories, he also wrote essays on nonviolence which influenced Gandhi and Martin Luther King. He extensively read the classic Vedanta literature and also read about Sri Ramakrishna and the writing of Swami Vivekananda. On September 13, 1896, Tolstoy wrote to Anendra Kumar Datta, who had sent him Vivekananda's book, Lectures on Raja Yoga, quote, I received your letter and the book, and thank you very much for both. The book is most remarkable, and I have received much instruction from it. The metaphysical side of the doctrine, the precept as to what is the true I of man, is excellent. Tolstoy wrote to a friend, quote, Ramakrishna, I know, and I have many excerpts of his sayings from theosophy journals. Tolstoy also mentioned that a friend has sent me extracts of Mueller's book on Ramakrishna. His selection of the sayings is wonderful, a most brilliant wise man. These and other early American influences led up to the organization of the World's Parliament of Religions in Chicago in 1893. Religious leaders from all over the world, from every religion, denomination, and sect were represented. The Parliament provided the platform and a very receptive audience for Swami Vivekananda, who lived the life and preached the truth of the Vedas. This is not to say that everyone was embracing the Vedanta point of view after that gathering. Even while it was still going on, a group of conservative Christian ministers denounced the whole idea of the Parliament for daring to compare Christ to other religions. Vivekananda's appearance at the Parliament was no doubt a major turning point for Vedanta throughout the Vedantic thought through the West. With the establishment of permanent Vedanta centers, people now could hear lectures, get personal instruction, and if so inclined, become monastics. No longer would Americans have to rely on books alone for learning about Vedanta. After the Parliament, Swami Vivekananda toured the U.S., meeting many famous people, holding lectures and classes, attracting dedicated individuals, and writing books for a Western audience. The Swami wrote a letter about a social gathering that was held at Sarah Bernhardt's apartment in Manhattan, where he met Nikola Tesla, a visionary in the field of electricity. For those who don't know, it was Tesla who first invented radio, alternating current, which is still the standard throughout the world, and many other practical applications. Tesla was also the man who lit up the 1893 Chicago World's Fair, which the Parliament was a part of. It was a big attraction to the World's Fair that it was lit up with these electric light bulbs.
When you think of electricity, you think of Edison. When you think of radio, you think of Marconi. But there is one electrical genius who is nearly forgotten. A man who dreamed of giving the world an unlimited supply of energy. His name was Nikola Tesla, and he was the master of lightning.
This program was made possible by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Tesla developed a deeper interest in Eastern thought and spiritualism.
Mr. Tesla was charmed to hear about the Vedantic prana and akash and the kalpas, which he claims are the only theories modern science can entertain.
Inspired by the Hindu teacher, Swami Vivekananda, Tesla began to look at the universe as a symphony of vibrations and waves.
We are whirling through endless space with an inconceivable speed. Everything is spinning. Everywhere there is energy.
In the same letter PBS quotes from there, Vivekananda wrote, Mr. Tesla thinks he can demonstrate mathematically that force and matter are reducible to potential energy. The letter was dated February 13, 1896, 10 years before Einstein published his work on the equivalence of matter and energy, represented by his famous symbolic formula, E equals mc squared.
William James was a pioneering American psychologist and philosopher who met Swami Vivekananda several times. In fact, he offered Swamiji a department chair at Harvard. James had this to say, "The paragon of all unity systems is the Vedanta philosophy of India, and the paragon of Vedantist missionaries was the late Swami Vivekananda, who visited our land some years ago. I have just been reading some of Vivekananda's addresses in England, which I had not seen. The man is simply a wonder for oratorical power. The Swami is an honor to humanity."
During Swami Vivekananda's travel in America, he established a Vedanta Center in New York in 1894 and San Francisco in 1900. Four other direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna came to this country, spreading the message, establishing centers, and giving instruction to those who sought it. Those distinguished Vedanta pioneers, in addition to Swami Vivekananda, included Swami Saradananda, Turiyananda, Trigunatitananda, and Abhedananda. Together with a small, dedicated group of lay people, they built up the foundation of Vedanta in America. It was not always easy. At the beginning of the 20th century, people from India were considered colored and experienced harsh bigotry. And there was a strong Christian movement underway that became increasingly intolerant of other religions, which gave rise to modern fundamentalism. But slowly, more centers were established and memberships in the Vedanta societies grew. I want to focus on three particular Swamis from the second generation who came from India, Swami Prabhavananda of Hollywood, Swami Nikhilananda of New York, and Swami Satprakashananda of St. Louis. In the late 1930s, 40s, and 50s, both the Hollywood Center and the East Side New York Center started attracting intellectuals, writers, and celebrities, including Aldous Huxley, Christopher Isherwood, J.D. Salinger, and Joseph Campbell, plus a steadfast and growing congregation who greatly contributed to the work. I believe that through these three centers, there was a breakthrough of Vedanta ideas to mainstream American culture. No longer the sole province of academics and intellectuals, ordinary people could read about Vedanta, receive instruction, and practice the methods taught by these holy men. Swami Prabhavananda was sent to the United States in 1923. Initially, he was the assistant minister of San Francisco. After 2 years, he established the Vedanta Society of Portland. And then in 1929, he moved to Los Angeles, where he founded the Vedanta Society of Southern California. Swami's books have been required reading in university comparative religion courses for over 60 years. In 1938, he started a monthly magazine originally titled Voice of India, which in 1941 became Vedanta in the West. His original works include The Spiritual Heritage of India, an encyclopedia of the history and breadth of India religion, The Eternal Companion, The Life and Teachings of Swami Brahmananda, The Sermon on the Mount According to Vedanta, and Religion and Practice, and many others. His translation of the Bhagavad Gita and the Upanishads were particularly helpful in spreading the Vedanta message. His translation of the Gita has now sold over 1 million copies since its publication in 1944. Little is known about him now, but the first wave of English authors was actually Gerald Hurd, who is credited with introducing Vedanta and meditation to Aldous Huxley. In 1938, Hurd and Huxley immigrated to the U.S., settled in Hollywood. Initially, it was Hurd who sought out Swami Prabhavananda, looking for a real live Swami for instruction. Huxley soon followed. Hurd was initiated by the Swami, and Huxley and Christopher Isherwood soon thereafter. All three contributed to the work of the society with writing and lecturing. Hurd wanted to build a small college, a place where students could study and practice mystical teachings, a quasi-monastery to attempt to live according to the teaching. Using his own inheritance and donations from wealthy supporters, 300 acres of land was purchased, and in 1942, construction had begun. At one point, Aldous Huxley stayed there for 6 weeks, working on the perennial philosophy. Hurd maintained a very austere and difficult schedule, but by 1949, he realized that the experiment did not work, and he donated the land and buildings to Swami Prabhavananda and the Vedanta Society, and is still in use today as the Tribhuvana Ramakrishna Monastery. Aldous Huxley was born in England to a prominent family. Though not wealthy or part of British aristocracy, they were highly respected for their intellectual honesty, brilliance, and achievements. The Victorian poet and social critic Matthew Arnold was his great uncle. I love one of his sayings, "The free thinking of one age is the common sense of the next." Thomas Huxley was a biologist and Aldous Huxley's grandfather, who defended and helped establish Charles Darwin's theories on evolution. He was so tenacious in his debates and writing that he was nicknamed Darwin's Bulldog. He coined the term agnostic to describe his own views on theology, but this did not make him anti-religious. He just adopted the scientific view towards religion of experimentation and personal practice. In addition to this family heritage, part of Huxley's character was also formed by three early tragedies. When he was 14, his mother died. At 17, he was nearly blinded by illness. And at 20, his older brother, Trev, who he greatly admired, committed suicide. Against his family background, Aldous Huxley's early writing consisted of essays and a few novels. They communicated a skeptical outlook and cynicism. After the publication of Brave New World, his influence and reputation grew as a leading intellectual and social commentator. In the late 1920s, Huxley met Gerald Hurd, and they both became very active in the peace movement, as they saw the seeds of World War II developing almost immediately after World War I. They felt that war could be avoided if the world's governments worked together to resolve the crushing economic conditions in Europe. Also around this time, Hurd introduced Huxley to Vedanta and meditation. By the mid-1930s, it became obvious that war was inevitable, and Huxley turned his attention to finding the causes of war and what could be done about it. He concluded that the question of how to prevent war, quote, finally resolves itself into a religious problem, an uncomfortable fact which one must be prepared to face and which I have come during the last year to find easier to face. The evolution of Brave New World, the novel that put Huxley on the world stage, and Island, his last novel published just before his death, show the Vedanta influence. In Island, Huxley presents what he felt to be an ideal society. His later novels carried the Vedanta message to millions of readers. Many people didn't hear about Huxley's death on November 22, 1963, as all the news was focused on the assassination of President Kennedy. The novelist, poet, and academic C.S. Lewis also died on that day. If you saw the movie Cabaret, you know why Christopher Isherwood fled Europe in 1933. The movie is based on his autobiographical writings about living in pre-war Germany. He settled in Hollywood in the late 1930s. Although he had an unusually strong aversion to organized religion since childhood, because of his respect for Huxley and Hurd, he decided to give Vedanta a chance. Isherwood tested Swami in his first interview, fearing that his being a homosexual would result in a stern and harsh condemnation. His time with Swami Prabhavananda is documented in Isherwood's My Guru and His Disciple. Quote, "When I arrived, I was immediately," this is talking about his first appointment with Swami, "when I arrived, I was immediately aware of the atmosphere of calm. It was like a sudden change in altitude to which I should have to get accustomed. His smile was extraordinary. It was somehow so touching, so open, so brilliant with joy that it makes me want to cry. I felt terribly awkward, like a rich, overdressed woman in the plumes and bracelets of my vanity. Everything I said sounded artificial and false. I started acting a little scene, trying to appear sympathetic. I told him I wasn't sure I could do these meditations and lead the life I am leading. But the question I had actually come to ask him was far more serious one. If his answer was unsatisfactory to me, there would be no point in our ever seeing each other again. In essence, it was, can I lead a spiritual life as long as I'm having a sexual relationship with a young man? I do remember the Swami's answer. You must try to see him as the young Lord Krishna. I wasn't at all discouraged by the Swami's reply. What assured me, what convinced me that I could become his pupil, was that he hadn't shown the least shadow of distaste on hearing me admit to my homosexuality. I'd feared a blast of icy Puritanism. Certainly, he regarded my lust as an obstacle to my spiritual progress, but no more and no less than lust for a woman. Swami's attitude was like that of a coach who tells his athletes that they must give up smoking, alcohol, and certain kinds of food, not because they're inherently evil, but because they may prevent the athlete from getting something he wants much more. Of the three writers, Isherwood became the one most closely associated with Swami and the Vedanta Society. At one time, he even tried to be a monk living at the Hollywood Temple. His contribution to the literature of Vedanta in the West is considerable. In addition to his working with Swami on translations of the Gita, Shankara's Crest Jewel of Discrimination, and How to Know God, the Yoga Aphorisms of Patanjali's, he wrote the biography Ramakrishna and His Disciples. He seemed to avoid incorporating Vedanta directly in his early novels, but towards the end of his career, it came more to the surface, and Down There on the Visit, A Meeting by the River, and his nonfiction book, My Guru and His Disciple. I'll let Christopher Isherwood speak for himself to finish this section.
It was in America that I met this monk, Swami Prabhavananda, who was my great, one of the great people in my life. And I became interested in Hindu philosophy and so on. And then, of course, I spent a lot of time here with Gerald Hurd and Aldous Huxley.
Did they not influence you to go into Hindu philosophy?
Well, they introduced me to this man, but as a matter of fact, I was more directly involved with it than they became, because they had their own kind of things, you know, they were a bit...
What has it added to your life, the Vedanta, the Hindu philosophy?
A sort of foundation. I'm a sort of not exactly a pessimistic person, but a person who's always thinking, well now, suppose that happens, then what do you do? And at the back of it, now, is what I got out of being a Vedantist, really. I mean, that there's not that kind of ultimate terror.
How was it removed? How does Vedanta remove it?
Oh, well, if I started trying to tell you that, we should be here till long after midnight. And even then, I mean, everything one says is so subjective.
Yes.
I can only say it removed it for me. And when I say Vedanta, I mean, I don't for one moment regard this as a kind of cure-all. It made me see how many other ways there are of removing it.
Mm-hmm.
It just happened to be my way, that was all. It gave me a great increased respect for the other religions, for instance, which I had absolutely no use for at the time.
As I mentioned before, the New York Center on the west side of Manhattan was founded in 1894, but in 1933, Swami Nikilananda founded the Ramakrishna Vivekananda Center of New York on the east side of Manhattan. His writings, and especially translating and publishing the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, created a library of English language Vedanta scriptures and commentaries. The center thrived and attracted a substantial following, including two notable authors, Joseph Campbell and J.D. Salinger. Joseph Campbell was an American mythologist, writer, and lecturer who taught at Sarah Lawrence College for 38 years. In 1940, Campbell attended a lecture by Heinrich Zimmer, one of the century's most prominent religious philosophers, who was one of the influential personalities attending the New York Center. Zimmer's interest in Indian philosophy effectively changed the way many Westerners, including Campbell, looked upon the East. Campbell joined the center and worked on translations with Swami Nikilananda and helped with the editing of the Gospel. Campbell's most popular public recognition came from his collaboration with Bill Moyers on the PBS series The Power of Myth, which was broadcast in 1988.
What does it mean to have a sacred place?
This is a term I like to use now as an absolute necessity for anybody today. You must have a room or a certain hour a day or so where you do not know what was in the newspapers that morning. You don't know who your friends are. You don't know what you owe to anybody. You don't know what anybody owes to you. But a place where you can simply experience and bring forth what you are and what you might be. This is the place of creative incubation. And first you may find that nothing's happening there. But if you have a sacred place and use it and take advantage of it, something will happen.
This place does for you what the plains did for the hunter.
For them, the whole thing was a sacred place, do you see? But most of our action is economically or socially determined and does not come out of our life. I don't know whether you've had the experience I've had, but as you get older, the claims of the environment upon you are so great that you hardly know where the hell you are. What is it you intended? You're always doing something that is required of you. This minute, that minute, another minute. Where is your bliss station, you know? Mm. Try to find it. Get a phonograph and put on the records the music that you really love. Even if it's corny music that nobody else respects. I mean, the one that you like or the book you want to read. Get it done and have a place in which to do it.
Sadly, the series was broadcast the year following Campbell's death. He never knew how popular his ideas became, which discusses mythology, religious, and psychological archetypes. For a number of years, Campbell was the president of the New York Center. J.D. Salinger was notoriously secretive about his private life, so much so that he became a virtual recluse from 1965, the year his last story was published, until his death in 2010 at age 91. It's not known how he came to the East Side New York Center, but the influence on his personal philosophy and writing is obvious. If you read his stories in chronological order, you can trace the development of the Vedanta philosophy in his work, occasionally directly quoting from Ramakrishna, Vivekananda, and Vedanta, but in ways that are easy to miss. When I first read these stories in high school, the Vedanta references went right over my head, but I believe the philosophy behind the stories was part of what prepared me for the Gita. His last story was published in 1965 in the New Yorker magazine, titled Hapworth 16, 1924. The whole story is a very lengthy letter from a 7-year-old Seymour Glass at summer camp to his parents, requesting books, talking philosophy, along with camp gossip. Many people speculated that Salinger had stopped writing after that, since there was no more publications. But since the publication of her autobiography, Salinger's daughter Margaret explained they had been writing almost daily, filling filing cabinets with new stories and new novels, two new novels. He also provided instructions for his son how to publish the work after his death. Perhaps Salinger was practicing the core message of the Gita, to be detached from the rewards of your work. You have the right to work, but not for the fruits of your action. He was a writer, so he wrote, but no need to publish or be in the spotlight. After Salinger died, the New York Center allowed access to a few of his letters that he wrote to Swami Nikhilananda and his successor, Swami Adishwarananda. They show the warmth and respect Salinger felt towards the Swamis, the Center, and Vedanta philosophy. After hearing about Swami Nikhilananda's failing health, he wrote a letter. It may be that reading to a devoted group from the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna is all you do now, as you say, but I imagine the students who are lucky enough to hear you read from the Gospel would put the matter rather differently. Meaning, I've forgotten many worthy and important things in my life, but I've never forgotten the way you used to read from and interpret the Upanishads up at Thousand Island Park. In a 1975 letter to Swami Adishwarananda, he writes, I read a bit from the Gita every morning before I get out of bed, Swami Nikhilananda's annotated version. It seems such a reasonable pleasure to imagine that Shankara would have approved unreservedly of Swami's inspired intelligence, devotion, and authority. How could he not? When vital steps to meditation is completed, but completed is very probably the wrong word, perhaps he would consider bringing out a collection of the pieces. I greatly hope so. I would love to own such a book, and I can't imagine anyone who would not. The Vedanta Society of St. Louis was started by Swami Satprakashananda in 1938. Somewhat older than Prabhavananda and Nikhilananda, he was the scholar other Swamis turned to for opinions about translations and philosophical points. Now I have to tell the story of how Professor Smith came to Vedanta and the St. Louis Center. Huston Smith was born in China to Christian missionaries in 1919. He came to the U.S. for college thinking he'd be a missionary like his parents, but once exposed to the West, he changed course with the idea of becoming a professor of religion. He was attracted to the ideas of Henry Nelson Wyman regarding his theories on naturalism. It seemed to be scientifically based, logical, modern, and appealing to Huston. Here's how Wyman describes it. It's impossible to gain knowledge of the total cosmos or have any understanding of the infinity beyond transcending the cosmos. Consequently, beliefs about these matters are illusions, cherished for their utility in producing desired states of mind. Nothing can transform man unless it operates in human life. For his postgraduate work, Huston enrolled at the University of Chicago, where Wyman taught. He also married Wyman's daughter, Eleanor, who's now Kendra. But while doing research on the subject of pain, he ran across a book with the interesting title of Pain, Sex, and Time by Gerald Hurd. He started reading it that night and perhaps for the only time of his life, read the whole night through. The book shook his whole religious and philosophical foundation. He says he went to bed a naturalist, but got up a mystic. He made two vows then. He would not read anything else by Hurd until he got his PhD, and once he got his PhD, he would read everything by him. After being awarded his doctorate and having read all the books by Hurd he could find, he was determined to actually meet the author who changed his life. Through Hurd's publisher, Huston got in touch and arranged a trip from Denver, where he was teaching at the time, to Tribuco College in Southern California. Being that he was still in debt from student loans, he hitchhiked. It was in 1947. When he told Hurd he was about to move to St. Louis for a new teaching position, Hurd suggested he look up Swami Satprakashananda at the St. Louis Center. As Huston was leaving, Hurd asked him if he had liked to meet Aldous Huxley. Huston, who had been reading The Perennial Philosophy, jumped at the chance. Huston met Huxley at his desert cabin to the east of Los Angeles, and Huston fondly recalls them walking through the desolate landscape, discussing the early Christian desert fathers of the third century. This started a lifelong friendship between the two. When Huston was settled in St. Louis, he looked up the Vedanta Center and arranged to come to the next class that was open to the public. At the time, the center was just a rented apartment. At first he found the experience, these are his words, a little exotic with a Swami, he wasn't even sure what that was, dressed in strange robes in a mysterious Eastern decor. But once the class began and the Swami read a passage from the Upanishads and then explained the meaning, Huston recognized the format. It was the same as Bible study class. He was very impressed with the Swami and the discussion. After the class, he purchased a copy of the Swami Nikhilananda translation of the Upanishads and read it straight through. Huston reported he had never found so much truth in so few lines. That was the beginning of a 10-year intense teacher-student relationship. Huston had private classes every week with Swami on all aspects of Vedanta, the history and various branches of philosophy, and also gave him meditation instruction. As Huston became more involved at the center, he eventually became president of the society. When enough money had been raised, a search was conducted to find a suitable building, and one was found on Church Row, a street lined with houses of worship of various Christian denominations. But when the seller found out that it was a Swami from India who was the buyer, he refused to sell. It's not clear if he considered Swami a colored person or because he was a heathen. Huston Smith and his wife Kendra bought the property in their name and then turned it over to the society. At Washington University, Huston developed a course on the world's religion, which was developed into a TV series on NET, the predecessor of PBS. Then the series was turned into a book titled The Religions of Man, later renamed The World's Religions. It became a standard textbook for colleges and universities and now has sold over 2.5 million copies. Although he never gave up his Christian roots, Huston considers himself a Vedantist. He told me how he took his family to the Christmas celebrations at his Methodist church, where he was an assistant minister, but went to the Vedanta temple for his spiritual nourishment to hear the Swami speak on the message of Christ. In 1996, Bill Moyers devoted a 5-part PBS series to Smith's life and work titled The Wisdom of Faith with Huston Smith. In that series, Moyers interviews Smith about the world's religion and Smith's personal practices and views of religion.
What do you make of that Hindu proverb, there are realms of gold hidden in the depths of our hearts?
In the Upanishads, the philosophical versions and texts of Hinduism, there is a phrase that comes repeatedly like the clang of a gong. It's tat tvam asi, literally, that thou art. And what it means is that which we seek in Brahman, the divine, whatever you call it, is right here within you. You see, they begin by saying you can have what you want, and that sounds very good, but wait till you get to the climax, and then you've already got it. Well, why don't we? Doesn't feel like I've got it. And they say, well, that's no problem there, because the light of a lamp, the shade, can be covered with dust or soot or mud, even to the point where the light does not shine through at all. And that's our nature, that are the divine, which is completely present here, has been shadowed by bad karma, as a, and so the object of life is to free those little grains and flecks of karma until the light can be not only shine before other people, but can be experienced within you.
Huston Smith is living in Berkeley and still writing at age 93. There are many other notable people who are highly regarded in their fields and who have been influenced by Vedanta, though not directly involved with Vedanta centers. Here are a few examples. Carl Jung wrote, in addition to our immediate consciousness, which is a thoroughly personal nature, and which we must believe is the only empirical psyche, there exists a second psyche system of a collected, universal, and impersonal nature, which is identical in all individuals. At an early age, Erwin Schrödinger was strongly influenced by philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer. As a Nobel Prize-winning quantum physicist, he had a lifelong interest in the Vedanta philosophy, which influenced his theories on cosmology. In his book, What is Life?, he wrote about the possibility that the individual consciousness is only a manifestation of a unitary consciousness pervading the universe. Quote, this life of yours, which you're living, is not merely a piece of this entire existence, but in a certain sense is the whole. Only this whole is not so construed that it can be surveyed in one single glance. This, as we know, is what the Brahmins express in that sacred mystical formula, which is really so simple and clear, tat tvam asi, that thou art. In 1933, Robert Oppenheimer met the Indologist Arthur Ryder and learned Sanskrit at University of California, Berkeley. He read the Bhagavad Gita in the original language, and later he cited it as one of the books that most shaped his philosophy of life. He was the director of the World War II atomic bomb project, and when he witnessed the first bomb explosion, he quoted from the Gita, "Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds." Albert Einstein said, when I read the Bhagavad Gita and read how God created this universe, everything else seemed so superfluous. And Albert Schweitzer said, the Bhagavad Gita has had a profound influence on the spirit of mankind and its devotion to God, which is manifest by actions.
As described in Don Latin's book, Distilled Spirits, published in the summer of 2012, Alcoholics Anonymous founder Bill Wilson's early influences were William James and Carl Jung, and later became friends with and influenced by Aldous Huxley and Gerald Hurd. In fact, Hurd and Wilson met at Tribuco in the 1940s. Jimmy Kinnon was a member of AA, but in the early 50s he founded a parallel organization, Narcotics Anonymous, to specifically help addicts. Aside from the Vedanta influence he experienced through AA, he had an association with the Ananda Ashram Vedanta Center in La Crescenta, California, and his memorial service was held there. Esalen founders Michael Murphy and Richard Price were greatly influenced by Vedic thought. After spending some time in India at Sri Aurobindo's ashram and reading Huxley and Hurd, Murphy got together with Price and they met with Gerald Hurd to develop their concept of a human potential center in Big Sur, patterned after Hurd's Tribuco College.
George Harrison said, "By having money, we found that money wasn't the answer. We had lots of material things, but learned that we still lacked something."
Ravi in the sitar was kind of like an excuse, trying to find a spiritual connection. I read stuff by various holy men and swamis and mystics, and I went around and looked for them. Ravi and his brother gave me a lot of books by some wise men. One of the books, which was by a Swami Vivekananda, who said, "If there's a God, you must see him, and if there's a soul, we must perceive it. Otherwise, it's better not to believe. It's better to be an outspoken atheist than a hypocrite." And after all my life, I've been brought up, well, they tried to bring me up as a Catholic. They had told you to just believe what they're telling you and, you know, not to have the direct experience. And this, for me, going to India and hearing somebody saying, you know, no, you can't believe anything until you have direct perception of it. And I thought, wow, you know, fantastic, at last, you know, find somebody who makes some sense. And so I wanted to go deeper and deeper into that.
In the lyrics of the last album George Harrison recorded, he embedded lines from Swami Prabhavananda's How to Know God, even including the page number.
The soul does not love, it is love itself. It does not exist, it is existence itself. It does not know, it is knowledge itself. How to Know God, page 130.
Hollywood has been influenced by Vedanta. Here are a couple of examples. In 2006, the classical music composer Philip Glass, a follower of Vedanta, wrote a symphony titled The Passion of Ramakrishna. The 2000 film, The Legend of Bagger Vance, starring Matt Damon and Will Smith, lifted the whole plot from the Bhagavad Gita. The heroes and villains of the Star Wars film series was inspired by Joseph Campbell's work on myth and heroes. In 1896, Swami Vivekananda was in London and he gave a speech titled The Real Nature of Man, where he quotes from an ancient parable about a mother lion who was almost ready to give birth and was in search of prey. Seeing a flock of sheep, she jumped on them but died in the effort. But a little baby lion was born and was taken care of by the sheep, who brought it up as one of their own. And in time it became a big, full-grown lion, but it thought it was a sheep. One day another lion came in search of prey and was astonished to find that in the midst of this flock was a lion behaving like a sheep. He watched for his opportunity, and one day he found the sheep lion sleeping. He approached it and said, "You are a lion." He said, "No, I'm a sheep," cried the other lion, and could not believe otherwise. The lion dragged him to a lake and said, "Look here, here's my reflection in yours." It looked at the lion and then at its own reflection, and in a moment came the idea that was indeed a lion. The lion roared, the bleeding was gone. Then Vivekananda said to the audience, "You are lions. You are souls, pure, infinite, and perfect. The might of the universe is within you." Now here's a scene from Disney's The Lion King.
"Look down there.
Look
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
Go back. I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son and the one true king. Remember who you are.
There are, of course, many other groups representing different branches of Vedanta philosophy, some of whom have flourished since the early part of the 20th century. I'll just name a few. Maharishi Mahesh Yogi started the Transcendental Meditation Movement in the 1950s. The physicist turned spiritual guru transformed his interpretations of ancient Vedic scriptures and built up a following of about 6 million people worldwide. The Self-Realization Fellowship was founded in 1920 by Paramahansa Yogananda and has centers and affiliated meditation groups throughout Southern California and around the world. The International Society for Krishna Consciousness, more commonly known as the Hare Krishna movement, was founded in 1966 in New York City by A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami. Its core beliefs are based on the traditional Hindu scriptures, including the Srimad Bhagavatam and the Bhagavad Gita. Plus, there are traditional Hindu temples all across the country. Lisa Miller wrote in her 2009 Newsweek article, "We're All Hindus Now," quote, "Conservative Christians learn in Sunday school that their religion is true and others are false. Jesus said, 'I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.' Americans are no longer buying it." A couple of months ago, a Wall Street Journal article titled, "What Did J.D. Salinger, Leo Tolstoy, Sarah Bernhardt Have in Common?" Annie Bardak wrote about what she called, quote, "The surprising and continuing influence of Swami Vivekananda, the Pied Piper of the global yoga movement." For Vivekananda, who established the first Vedanta Center in Manhattan in 1894, yoga meant just one thing, the realization of God. One important effect of the Vedanta philosophy on society is religious tolerance. Many wars in human history, including the current war on terror, have religious roots and connections, though misguided. According to a recent Washington Post article, which reported results from a survey of 36,000 American adults, 70% of those people affiliated with the religion believe that many religions can lead to eternal salvation. And only about a quarter of those surveyed believe that there's only one way to salvation. Since religious pluralism is not an accepted doctrine of most Christian churches, it's remarkable that so many Americans embrace it. I've given a lot of anecdotal stories of famous individuals who have read, admired, embraced, and lived the Vedanta philosophy, and in many cases it changed their lives, careers, and through their work produced effects on society. Then why, after all this, is it that most Americans still haven't heard of Vedanta, Vivekananda, or Ramakrishna, even though other Eastern religious movements have flourished? Many decades ago, Swami Satprakashananda was asked, "Will Vedanta take root in the West?" He answered, "Yes, but the source will not be recognized." In response to the question of how can Vedanta become more popular, Swami Isherwood of Portland replied without hesitation, "Dilute the message." Obviously something he did not recommend or practice. The Rig Veda puts our philosophy clearly. Truth is one, sages call it by various names. The us versus them conflicts in current politics are to no small extent based on religious prejudice. If we take the Vedanta message to heart that our true inner nature is a shared and identical being, the Atman, how can we discriminate against others? There is no them, only us. Instead of seizing on our differences, we should recognize and embrace our common spiritual heritage. I'm content with the fact that Vedanta has had its influence on the West, even if most people can't name the source. If they take the message of Vedanta to heart without knowing the source, it's just right with me. Thank you.